All right, we just took a look at implementing gravity and the ability for Mario to jump. Now we're going to use that jumping to actually trigger some updates with the game world. So this is the block update, because so far we've had the yellow block that's been visible when we generate levels. And in Super Mario Brothers, it's actually frequent that you'll find blocks that you can hit as by jumping that will change the block's appearance. Either it will change it from yellow to, say, some darker color, or it'll actually destroy it altogether. In this example, we're just going to take the yellow block that we have already been using and essentially just swap it, its ID specifically, with another block, a darker brown one, when we hit it to sort of demonstrate this functionality. Now, collision detection in Super Mario Brothers, sort of in this context, is a little bit different than what we've done so far. We're still using AABB, but in this case, really what we're doing is only checking the top part of Mario, because all we're doing really when he jumps is just checking to see whether his head has intersected with something, not his entire body. So what we're essentially going to do is look at his top left corner and his top right corner, see if they are, you know, at any sort of particular tile in our world map that's not empty. And if they are, well, then if it's the block, then we'll just transfer it to the other block's ID. We'll switch it. And that's it really for the collision detection in terms of just the jumping. Mario 9 is going to be the collision update, where we look at the other directions that we can check for collision. For example, his feet and his sides. Currently, we don't have any collision for his sides or for his feet. He just walks across the map because we say that his height should be at that point when he's not in the jump state. But we'll correct that in the next section. So for this section, just because it's a little bit easy to screw up on this one, given how minute some of these changes are going to be, we're not going to do it all live. We're just going to take a look at the code sort of as it's been pre-baked. And the first thing that I want to draw your attention to is map tile at. So it's a new function that takes in an X and a Y. This is a fairly easy part of this update here. But all we essentially want to do is specify, or rather we want to pass in an X and a Y as pixel coordinates, not as tile IDs, you know, in this sort of grid space that we've been doing so far with the tile map. In this case, we want to pass in our actual X and Y pixel value. So wherever our Mario avatar might be walking around, we want to get the pixel, we want to get the tile that's at that pixel location. So what we do is we do our classic getTile function, which takes in the X and Y at the grid level. In this case, though, what we're doing is we're taking our X divided by the tile width, and then we're adding one to that. And the result of that is, because it's one, because everything is one index relative to get tile, this is essential because we're dealing with pixel values, and that'll end up going back to a zero-based system. We want to worry about a one-based system in this case. Same thing with tile height, y divided by self.tile height plus one will give us the tile that is at that particular, you know, we're essentially dividing our xy by the map tile size and condensing it down to what it maps to at the grid, and sort of accounting for that with the plus one. Now, in order to make use of this, in the player update function, we're adding a little bit of code here, starting on line 149. And what we're really doing is only checking if our self.dy is less than zero, meaning that we're jumping up towards the air. We can still be in the jumping state and have a positive dy, but at that point, we're not going to check for jumping anymore. We only want to check to see whether we've hit a tile with jumping when our dy is negative, so when we're actually jumping up into the air. And what we want to do is use that new tile or tile at function as part of the map class to check our own self.x and self.y, as well as our self.x plus our self.width minus one. And the reason that we do this is, again, because interestingly, we can be, because we're dealing with pixel values, we can be between two blocks at one time. And so this is kind of a way to catch slight bugs where, for example, if there are two blocks together and we jump and we're only checking this left corner, it'll only trigger this block to change. But we actually want both of these to be valid because, you know, we're essentially in between both of them. It should check the collision accordingly. And we'll do the same thing for the left and the right sides and the bottom of them as well when we get to that section. But that's why we're doing an OR here. We're essentially saying if the tile at his left corner or the tile at his right corner are empty, are not empty, and that's what this tilde is. The tilde equals means not equals. This is a Lua-specific piece of syntax. If it is not equal to tile empty, both of these, then that means we have hit something. So we can set our self.dy equal to zero in that case. We've instantly hit something, we can start going back down because remember, we're still in the jump state, so gravity is gonna kick in and push us back down to the ground. We don't wanna keep jumping through the block if we hit it. We wanna actually, you know, sort of mimic as if we had hit it physically. And then we do this bit of code here, which basically just checks both of those sides, tile map at self.x and self.y, and self.x and self. Plus self.width minus 1 and self.y, if they're equal to jump block. And if they are, then all we're going to do is set the maps tile at that particular location to jump block hit, which we have declared way up here as a new, that's in the map file here. If we go to the map file up at the top, or sort of towards the top, we'll see that jump block hit is equal to the value of 9. And all we're essentially doing really is replacing, therefore, the block as it currently was, which was the jump block, and we're essentially just doing, we're just flipping its ID, and because we're rendering this every single frame, it's seeing that now the number is not 5, it's 9, so we should therefore render the hit block. So really we're not doing much besides just flicking a number, changing a number, and that's giving it the appearance of hitting a block and changing its shape. So I'm gonna go ahead and run this just so we can test it out. Go ahead and run that. So we spawned right below a few blocks conveniently. If I jump right below this yellow block, we do indeed see that we hit it, we stopped our velocity, and because of gravity, we ended up coming back down. And additionally, we flipped the block such that now it's no longer a yellow block, it is a brown block. So that's really it as far as colliding with up above the character. In the next section, the collision update, we're going to do something a little more sophisticated. We're going to look at left and right collision as well as floor collision and stop really treating the ground as a sort of a constant hard-coded value that we need to align Mario to and instead let him fall through gaps, for example, in the ground. So we'll see you at Mario 9.